poor speaker wears many hats as a good husband, father, grandfather, foster father, minister, and serves on many non-profit boards. And last but not the least, he is a Toastmaster for the last 17 years. Tonight, he's doing Project 10 from 10th CC manual that's inspired your audience. His speech title is Overcome. Please help me welcome our distinguished Toastmaster, Mr. Roger Pritchard.
Mr. Toastmaster and fellow Toastmasters, when we were young, it was the boogeyman in the night or the monster under the bed. Now, more than likely, it's the boogeyman in the next office or asking for that promotion. Fear. In recent months, I've come to realize how significant our fears are. In my work as a coach for missionaries, I've recognized how fear can strangle us and keep us from achieving our potential. Here at Toastmasters, we know better than most how fears can affect us, especially that common fear of public speaking. Isn't it interesting that everyone walking through those doors looks capable and competent? We tend to walk in projecting an aura of confidence, a can-do spirit. But the truth is, many of us are fearful, and some are especially so. Now, our fears can be rational or irrational. We tend to have the irrational fears when we're younger and our reasoning abilities are not so developed. That's the fear of the monster under the bed or of the shadows on the wall at night. But even our rational fears can be paralyzing. In a problem economy like we have now, we can have great fears of losing a job. A serious accident can keep us from driving. Or a near drowning can make us petrified of swimming. Your fears can loom large, fellow Toastmasters, overshadowing other aspects of life. Sometimes we think we're the only one with fears, but the truth is that we all have fears, and the list of fears is long. Heights, snakes, falling, deep water, crowds, getting lost, guns, losing a job, public speaking, going bankrupt, flying in a plane, Alzheimer's, failing a course, spiders, and on we could go. There are lots of different fears, and we all have them to one degree or another. I don't do well with heights. When I was a young man, I went with a friend and we decided to go up a ski lift. I think the imprint of my hand is still on that center pole of the ski lift because I would not let go. And I threatened my friend with life and liberty if he shook that chair. A couple of years ago, we went to Walt Disney World and rode in a very popular ride called, I think it's called California Dreaming. It gives you the sense that you're gliding in the air. They put you in a chair, and the chair moves a little bit, but basically it's stationary. It just makes some very small moves. They've got a fan blowing air in your face, and then they've got a giant IMAX-like screen there where you're soaring over mountains and across the ocean. I had to keep my eyes closed for all but about 10 seconds of that because I don't do well with heights. I am afraid of heights. And so I want to ask you, what are you going to do with your fears? Well, first of all, I suggest you need to know and assess your fears. It was Socrates who said, "The unexamined life is not worth living." We can hum through life trying to ignore our fears, but life will be less than the best it could be. I encourage you to take some time in the near future to think about your fears. And some fears matter a lot more than others. I know about my fear of heights, and I'm not particularly worried about it. It doesn't keep me from flying or going up in tall buildings, skyscrapers. But I'll probably never be a pilot or do a bungee jump. I'm not going to pay to go out on that glass walkout over the Grand Canyon. If, however, you've been burned in love and now have a fear of it, that's debilitating. That affects your relationships for the rest of your life. And as has been said, it is better to have loved and lost than to never have loved at all. You need to confront that fear and do something about it. Awareness is a significant part of the solution. And then you need to face your fears. Helen Keller. Blind and deaf from a very young age, said, "Avoiding danger is no safer in the long run than outright exposure. The fearful are caught as often as the bold." You can try to avoid or ignore your fears, but that is not a good solution. They won't go away by themselves. A couple of decades ago, a fellow by the name of Jim Fix started a craze of jogging in the United States. And as life would have it, Jim died of a heart attack while he was jogging one day. Should we then develop a fear of jogging? I might die of a heart attack while I'm jogging. But don't you see that I'm just as likely to die of being a couch potato too? So a fear of jogging is not the answer. After you know your fears and determine which ones you need to overcome, then you need to face them. And finally, take some action. You have done that with public speaking, or you wouldn't be here. Now, do it again with another fear. Dale Carnegie said, "Inaction breeds doubt and fear. Action breeds confidence and courage. If you want to conquer fear, do not sit at home and think about it. Go out and get busy." And so we need to talk about our fears. Don't let it hide. Divide and conquer. I know a lady who had a fear of flying. Now, this was before 9/11, and you could still do this. But to help conquer her fear, she went down to the airport and asked, "Could I just go sit in a plane?" And that helped her. One step at a time. Ask others to help you. Sometimes someone can walk alongside as you face your fear. Sometimes a fear is so serious that we need professional counseling. That's okay. Do it. A missionary I know was struggling with his work. He wasn't having much success and had lost his drive. I believe that he really wanted to leave his work so that he could do something better. I coached him in that direction, helping him confront his fears of stopping what he was doing. I believe he had a fear of stopping what he was currently involved in. And it turned out to be true. And now he's on his way to a new path that will be much better for him and his family. Wouldn't it be nice if confronting every fear was as nice as what we do here in Little Rock Toastmasters? Every time you do some little positive step, a drop of applause, just standing up and saying the word of the day or the joke, and we applaud you. Sometimes you might wonder, do we really need to have all that applause? I think so. It's encouraging. It helps. Where else can you receive so much encouragement at one time? Lots of applause for every little victory. And by the way, that's the way we help children learn and grow too. Some of you know that I have a 10 and a half month old foster child, and he's crawling around. We call him a race crawler. He's so fast, and he can stand up on his own now, and it's just a matter of days before he's walking. And every time we see some little bit of progress, we clap and say yay, and he has a great big smile. It would be so nice if we could confront our fears that way, with so much applause and cheering on for every little victory. But for some of our fears, we're going to have to set up our own little internal encouragement system, our own little applause system. And so, when you face your fears, give yourself kudos when you advance. And so, in summation, your fears are real. They can hinder you, but they can be overcome. Don't shrink back. Know them. Face them. And take action. You can do it. Ooh.